मेरा नाम शेनान सिंह है और मेरे पिताजी शहीद भगत सिंह से तीसरे नंबर पे छोटे भाई थे, सॉरी चौथे नंबर पे। उनका और भगत सिंह की उम्र का 18 साल का अंतर था, तो इसका मतलब ये हुआ कि जब भगत सिंह को फांसी हुई तो मेरे पिताजी 6 साल के थे। तो मैं जो यहाँ खड़ा हूँ बात करने के लिए आपसे, किसी खास क्लेम नहीं है, इट इज़ ओनली बिकॉज ऑफ द क्लेम ऑफ एक्सीडेंट ऑफ बर्थ, सो डोंट एट्रीब्यूट टू मच नॉलेज टू मी, बट इट इज एट द सेम टाइम नॉट वेरी कन्वीनियंट टू द लास्ट स्पीकर। फॉर अ लास्ट स्पीकर इट इज असेंशियल दैट इट मस्ट बी गुड इन ड्रामेटिक्स और इज कंटेंट मस्ट बी वेरी गुड। So I don't know how the content is going to be, but I hope it is interesting because it is not my content, it is Bhagat Singh's content. So I hope you all will enjoy it and understand what I am going to say. So as today's subject is the relevance of Bhagat Singh in contemporary times. It's interesting, the book that Chamanji has written or compiled is what was done then, but we are trying to get a reflection of that on today's time. And in 2019 it so happens that another writer, Chris Moffat, have done great research and written a book called India's Revolutionary Inheritance. So what we are talking today, relevance, is actually his inheritance that we are talking about. So when I am on the subject of inheritance, I must start and make my talk a little more interesting. हिंदुस्तान में एक joke है, वो ये है कि हमें आज दौलत है एक भगत सिंह के पैदा होने की, लेकिन वो मेरे घर में नहीं होना चाहिए, मेरे पड़ोस के घर में। इसकी वजह क्या है? इसकी वजह यह है कि जो भगत सिंह की पर्सनैलिटी है, जो उन्होंने कहा है, जैसा हम समझते हैं, उसमें बहुत सारा कुछ जो करना चाहिए था वो नहीं हुआ और उसको करना आसान काम नहीं है, तो इसलिए हम ये चाहते हैं कि कोई और करे, हम ना करें। So relevance is there in everybody's mind, it is desire, people want that whatever he thought should happen, somebody should do it, but I shouldn't be the one who should be doing it. I spent 70 years of my life not done anything about it. So I don't blame people who only think and not do, but I appreciate those who at least think, so sometimes it will happen. This joke is relevant because this man in his introductory para speaks for. So he is sitting in England, has done research, come here, met lots of people, even Professor Irfan, Habib, he spent time in Lahore, published his book and released it in Lahore. He thought it relevant, and why he thought it relevant is the same reason that there is still a great amount of struggle which is left to be done, which is the legacy of Bhagat Singh, which some generation, somebody, one man, 20, 10, 15, we started with a gathering of about 68 people here, we went up to 103, then we depleted again, but even two are enough. I'm quite contented with the number that is available, that I can speak to. And, but any one person who can think, can generate that momentum. Adi Guru Shankaracharya died at the age of 32, but he created the four walls of this nation, the concept of the nation of Hindustan. So one man at that time, there was nothing in the form of radio stations and printing presses and all, and he was from South, yet he could create a small deity, Shivaji of South, his village deity, as the supreme deity of this country, because of his conviction and the way he communicated with people. So one man who can communicate, Bhagat Singh did succeed in communication. These are the people who have, we say, an aptitude for being a doctor or an aptitude for being an engineer. These people had an aptitude to be leaders and thinkers. They had the capacity to think in more than two dimensions. That's why they did what they did in this small span of life. When we talk of inheritance, I am reminded of a couplet written by Farak. He says, "Ae ahle nazar aao, ye jaagir sambhalo." Those who have the vision, please come forward and take this jaagir. Main mumlikat e lauh kalam baant raha hoon. Matlab meri jaagir jo hai wo kagaz aur kalam hai. Main wo baant raha hoon jinke paas nazar hai aao aur le lo. If we see Bhagat Singh in that concept of his inheritance, then we can understand that we don't have to play those actions. We have to understand his thought. We have to understand him. And fortunately for us, he has left so much in writing. This much in writing. So much. So we have to understand it. We have to analyze and spend our time on thinking and applicability and what he wanted and how he thought. That will automatically create that army of people who will do what is required to be done. A revolution is, in simple scientific terms, to rotate. I'm an engineer, graduate from Mukhia, so I can only think in simple terms. A revolution is, for a state, for a country, is something where the concepts should change. What we have done is that we have created a murti of democracy, and we are playing musical chairs around it. Where the aim is to sit on that chair. How you sit it doesn't make a difference. What you do when you sit doesn't make a difference. So a revolution would be when we change this murti and not how we run around it. You meant to say today our country does not have 544 sane thinking people? We don't have them, but we can't find them. Why do we have to depend on a political party to tell us, okay, elect this guy? What is happening to other 8 to 10 lakh people in a constituency? They can't find one man out among them, sir, who is not, nominated by a confused party, which doesn't have a memorandum, or if it has. So I don't understand that how does it happen that a person who was in Congress till yesterday, suddenly his manifesto, his memorandum, his thinking, his concept of life, everything changes and he puts on a yellow cloth on his shoulders and he becomes a citizen. It's quite confusing to me and I don't understand it. But one thing I can understand, that we are incapable of finding 544 people. If that is what it is, then we need to change the system, the way we create our government. We have to do something about it. We just can't have the system that there was British rule, then there was semi-dynastic democratic rule, then there was religious fundamentalism rule, and then what happened? We have to do something about it so that we can say that this happened. So when we talk of relevance of Bhagat Singh, he is relevant. Not only he, anybody who is a beneficiary of this country is relevant today. Only thing is that he should have the courage to at least to speak. Today, even that is possibly not a thing which is easily available, the courage to say what you think or courage to speak your mind out. When we talk of Bhagat Singh, suddenly something happened in the beginning of 21st century. 2007 was his birth anniversary. And at that time, three main things happened. One was his birth anniversary. Second was that suddenly the Bollywood produced 6-7 movies on him. The most effective and thought-provoking being Ranbir Singh. I mean, Asgor also, they showed a macho figure of Bhagat Singh, a strong man who would yell more things, less, etc. But Rangde Basanti had profound effect on number of people. This was second event which suddenly brought him to thinking mind. The third thing was total absence of Bhagat Singh's name, his thinking, his work from the official history of independence and struggle from this country. It was just missing, either deliberately or maybe that possibly people wanted to give more importance to non-violence and the government which came into effect after partition, after independence, was basically of those people who wanted to propagate the theory of non-violence, because they did not want that violence which was against the British to come up against them in case of their failure. A non-violence as a concept also is very questionable. Means when I look at the and he actually went on to recruit people to join army to fight. In at least in Boer War, he only recruited literature leaders. This time he recruited combatants to take part in war along with the British. So you can imagine that if I want independence from British, I would want them weak. I would rip them when they are weak. I will rip them where I want them to get defeated. Not that I will first go and support them elsewhere, make them strong, and then with folded hands request them, please give me independence. That means it conveys one thing, that dying outside the boundaries of India is no violence. But dying inside the boundaries of India is violence. And same thing happened in Second World War. Though I am told, I read it also written, that Mahatma Gandhi was not very favorable to Indian troops joining British army in that. But I think that was only more of a appearance to think, because 2.5 million, 25 lakh Indians they joined. 5 lakh Indians were gone. हमारा सारा अनाज गोदामों में बंद कर दिया गया. हम लोग भूखे मरे. यहाँ पे भूखमरी आ गई, लेकिन वो अनाज सेकंड वर्ल्ड वॉर में हम यूरोपियन अलाइड पावर्स को खाने के लिए दिया गया ताकि वो लड़ाई कर सके. So that they become a strong nation, and then again with folded hands we can require them to give us independence. I don't understand this. How can you justify 5 lakh people dying in a war and call yourself non-violent and say this is a country of 5 lakh people, 2 lakh people in Hindustan have died from the lakh people, you would have got independence then, you wouldn't have waited till 48 or 7. So this concept of non-violence is questionable. I think there should be research on this. Somebody should be awarded a PhD, not me, but somebody else should be given a PhD on doing this, to break this shackle of thinking that non-violence is the greatest thing. And look, how many countries have made a fool of us by putting Mahatma Gandhi's statue at number of places. Means if they want to tell us that we are so well-wishers, they just put a statue of Mahatma Gandhi and we go running and they become our friends. Jappi dal dete. Not like Abhi Dodi, but rather different. We need to question. Bhagat Singh demands it. What is nationalism? What is it? I am quite confused. I do not know it. If you ask me to define, maybe I will go till morning and I won't be able to define what is nationalism. It's very confusing. So we have to find answer to this. I have not left a sufficient number of years to live and find what is nationalism. What should constitute nationalism for a person who lives in a state? For him, what should be nationalism? Is nationalism praising a man who has won in that musical chair and sat on the chair? Is that nationalism? Or nationalism is running around that chair? What is nationalism? Means I'm quite confused. And nationalism needs to be done. And we need to understand that what is the limit of demanding people to become nationalists rather than living their normal lives? Is it essential that anybody who is living should be a nationalist? What was the purpose of a state? Why was the state created? It was a very noble concept. वो पहले फैमिली होती थी, फिर कबीला हो गया, फिर एक क्लैन बन गया, उसके बाद फिर एक उन्होंने छोटी सी जगह के ऊपर कब्जा कर लिया, फिर वो स्टेट बन गई. नाउ व्हेन दैट बिकेम स्टेट देन इट बिकेम करप्ट. इट स्टार्टेड स्ट्राइकिंग अगेंस्ट अदर सच स्मॉल स्टेट्स एक्वायरिंग देयर वेल्थ. वेल्थ एट दैट टाइम वाज नंबर ऑफ पीपल, लैंड एंड कैटल. सो दे स्टार्टेड स्नैचिंग दैट. So this room into say that for me the nationalism should be that I should go and take land up to Karachi, then I'll be called a nationalist. Or should I try and see that my children are not fed namak and roti? At the same time, when on a Chaiwala's birthday, crores of rupees are splurged at the prisoner is not even present. So what is this? What is nationalism? Why should for me the nationalism should not be to ensure that nobody falls sick, there is no malaria, there is no typhoid. Even Bhagat Singh has spoken in his manifesto of Mahajan Bharat Sabha about the diseases and the actual subject matter. So is he not relevant in these issues? Why are we talking so big? Nationalism means we go to I don't know what place and bombard them again. I have been in army all my life, I have served in army. Let me tell you, there is a most badly exploited power of the government. Most badly exploited. They are not, they have no opportunity to say what they want to say. I went to Sri Lanka. I spent 3 years there. 3 years and 2 months. When we went, I told my troops, look, we have come to help Tamils because these poor people are not being permitted equality in their own nation. So we are here to help them. 6 months later, we were killing same Tamils in the support of Sinhalas. And when we came, Sinhalas and Tamils both were killing us. this army is very badly exploited. Now today, when let's say that in Jallianwala Bagh, that incident happened 100 years ago, the people who came and fired, they had no nothing to do with it, they fired very efficiently. Because in that small little place, they deployed so many single shot guns and 3-4 holes and they continued. They were very efficient people, I would say. But who told them to fire and why? And what is the change today? Is the army not being told to do the same thing in Kashmir? Are those people not human beings? In what manner is their blood different from the blood of those people who died in Jallianwala? Why should it be so? Why are people in Northeast being since 1956 the army has been deployed there with Armed Forces Special Power Act? Why? What's the problem? So is this nationalism? To see and look at these things and eradicate them and let people live peacefully and proper. Means people should be able to grow without fear. Today, in Bombay, I have seen a huge lines in front of banks because banks have been told that they can't disperse more than 1,000 rupees to people. Means, people are being given a thing to get worried about every day. Means, if I am told that tomorrow there will be NRC in Delhi, I should be more worried whether my wife's name will be there or not, rather than thinking about the nationalism and nationality or whatever. Am I thinking of the good for the poor, education of the children, development, science, landing on the moon, or I'm thinking about my national register? What is this? Why this fear is being created? This fear is being created just to create another Hitler. Can't we see that? Is nationalism something that we should be worried about this? Or at the same time, I should be shown more this thing because Pakistan has reactivated X, Y, and Z place and therefore they must be eliminated there. Why is it that in 1948 when the Sikh regiment in Tutaputa Vajra, they went to Srinagar, Godewala, Cyclewala, Rishewala, Tangewala, Paisal, Bakriwala, Bedwala, everybody helped this Indian army to move towards Baramula. Men, women, children, Buddha, Jitne, Joshkuma, Zohi Kusta, they were all Kashmiris. Why did they support this Indian government at that time and why they want to kill us today? What have we done? why in 1947, Bardolai, the older one, he wanted to be part of India and he came to Mahatma Gandhi and said, look, Jawaharlal Nehru is giving me away, giving the northeast away from Kashmir, we want to be part of India. And suddenly in 1956, there was a movement and they are fighting against insurgencies from that time. There is something wrong. We are missing that thing. What is that thing? We are not caring for people. We consider people as commodity. The responsibility of the state is not to care for them. Why is the police still protecting the politician? Why is the police not protecting the civil purpose? During British time, a policeman was given nothing other than a gun. So when he was posted to a police post, his job was to first go, chai wale ko danda mara, chai lao, voter wale ko mara, khana lao, dhobi ko mara, kapde paras karo. Today, all police stations, there is no mess, there is no medical facility, there is no place where they can sleep, there is no dhobi, there is no transport for them. How do they survive? By hitting the public and getting that from them. Aim at that time was to create the fear of police in the minds of the people. But today, is it so? Do we want to create the fear of police in the minds of the people? Or we want to use the police to protect the people? So what is happening? Why are we unnecessarily looking at I'm a national or I'm not a national? Or everything which is being done to me is being done to me by my state. So shouldn't I fight to survive? If people are fighting to survive, they are called nation. What is the reason that for 70 years there are places where school children still have to tie the rope on the rivers and cross the rivers, and they are sometimes shown to us as a fun on TV during monsoons? But that's not the only thing. During peace time, during the time when there are no floods, pregnant women, old people, sick, others, they still have to cross those places and get to the hospitals. A person to sell his farm produce has to travel 40 kilometers to go around and come to a town which is just a thousand miles. Instead of reducing those difficulties, what we have done, you go to Patot in Srinagar, and sorry, in Jammu area, Chenab River, which used to flow and people used to go down, cross on a small boat and get to the other side and they used to marry their children across the river. Now a dam has been created. There is a huge river, I mean about 100 meters, 200 meters wide, and it's fast flowing, nobody can go across. Those people whose daughters are married on the other side, they have to travel 30 kilometers down, cross somewhere and then come up 30 kilometers again in the mountains to go and say hello to your grandchildren. So is this what a nation does? Is this what a state does to look after its people? Why couldn't they put up a floating bridge, a boat bridge or something at 10 kilometers each so that people can cross? They should have made their life more comfortable. But it has not been done. So where did this state thing stop troubling people and start looking at their children? People are, they are not anti-nation, they are just trying to survive. They were trying to live. Pakoda bina ke chai bhej do, bina ke bhej do, you are employed. But you make pakoda outside, by any three police wallahs will come and take money from you. By next week the municipality corporation chairs will come and they will take money from you. So there is this employment. And then the other people will also come. Yeh iska hygiene standard theek nahi hai. Ye paani mein kaun sa rehta hai? Tumhare nakhun dikhao. Tumhare gloves kyun nahi hai? Fir to koto ka kyun nahi hai? So how can you sell pakoras and be employed? So even that person who is somehow trying to survive is not being permitted to survive. So therefore, today the question of this person is anti-national means it is something which is ridiculous. We should not even talk about it. Let him survive. Let that poor man live. Usko roti to kha lene do. Usko bachcha school mein jata hai. Usko namak ke saath roti le lete. The woman who recently won 1 crore in Kaunbani ka Karopati, people may have been fascinated by her knowledge and all, but what depressed me most was that she is getting 1500 rupees per month to feed 450 people every day. What is the minimum wage? 300 rupees? 250 rupees? Where is that minimum wage applicable to her? Because the minimum wages are not even being paid to the teachers yet. Forget about this cook. So, means, do you expect that woman to be nationalist? Why is she not married? I don't expect. We need to question the nation. We need to question, are the people for the state or the state for the people? Bhagat Singh asked these questions and I tried to answer them also. Which should be our thought basis thing? There is a need to be convinced. What I have written is not what I am speaking. What I am speaking is coming from within me. What I have written is something which I thought that maybe something will not come from within me. So, unless that thing comes from inside you, it is not there. Even Hitler has written in his book Mein Kampf that if you remember what is written on what page of which book, it has no value. You should understand what that book has taught you and should be able to give a practical shape to it. So we may read Constitution, we may read Bhagat Singh, we may read this. We may read this, it doesn't really make a difference unless our heart and mind is in the proper place, and at some times we should not care. If every time we care, mere bachche ko kya ho jayega, usko kya ho jayega, nothing will ever happen. No wars, practically, no wars. No state has ever won a war. Unless the younger generation of soldiers took part in it. If you see any history of any war, the older soldiers like me get decorated, they get Veer Chakra and other things, but the younger ones die. And that is what decides the war. You see Russian Revolution, you see First World War, you see Second World War. Unless that bill type thing, a whole lot of people come and go, unless that happens, nothing can. If you see the recently the war that we fought in 1999 and 2000, Kargil War, there was only one war, and people, army was being pushed. The people who were ahead, they had no choice to run back because the whole army was behind them. So those who fought very bravely were those who happened to be in front and they had no choice. If anyone of you has ever gone for a Ganga Snan, the guy who sits in the clothes and the family is taking bath, ultimately he also takes bath with his clothes because the other people come and push him into Ganga and he has no choice. There is so much of crowd. So, therefore, it is the younger generation and which is available in large numbers which will change our nation. And why we talk young? Because they think less and do more. Not a very good quality, but what's useful sometimes. So, therefore, those older people who at some times must think less, they should use their experience to guide this thoughtless crowd and mob. So then the nation will possibly reach to this. But unfortunately, I get my pension. When I speak, I am worried. Is there any pension to me? How can I speak freely? There have to be, at some time, there will to sacrifice. Nothing more will happen than dying, and so many people have died. This is a universal fact. Everybody will die. So will I die. So, if unless you can think like that, a nation is never made. So, as a person, you think, "Kaam milega, kaam karunga, kya karunga, wo karunga." Nahi milega, to kya karega? You can die. Why not? Authorities and all, for a period of time, they have tried to create an environment where Bhagat Singh should be seen as a man who only belonged to Punjab. See this book. About whom is it? Do you have to read the name? The writer is here. I had the good opportunity to discuss with him why this Because it conveys everything, it tells you this Bhagat Singh. Not only him, there is another guy, no photo book, no face. But you tell the government of India to do something for Bhagat Singh, they will make a Jude Wala Sikh, put him in the parliament, a kurta pehna ke, even Bhagat Singh will fail to recognize by his CV parliament. He will not recognize. Why is it not? I was invited as a family member, I was invited to attend that function, I declined. They asked me, kya ho gaya? I said, look, firstly, give him a hat so that people can recognize him. Second thing is that he wasn't alone in parliament, but he was also there. If you are celebrating an event, you are giving a weapon. So why have you excluded the poor man only because he doesn't have a vote bank? So, Bhagat Singh has a vote bank in Punjab. That is why a photo in Pagadi. And that, so what they are trying to do, they are trying to push Bhagat Singh into Punjab. But they can't do it because most of the Punjabis have gone abroad. Related to them, so there must be people who should call voicing them and I shouldn't call them and get a couple of things and some snacks. No. It is because this group of people which is in four walls of a place called India need his thinking. They need his type of thinking. Even if it is 10%, 15% this side, that side, but doesn't make a difference. Lekin marne ko kya ho? Maro to. Kisi bhi tarah se maro. Do something. But not doing anything is not an excuse. I like this word, the one whom everybody is trying to call. क्या उसको बोल रहे हैं उसको उसके मुकदमा चलाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं हाँ कन्हैया कन्हैया you know one sentence only one sentence that is spoke which is so relevant. He says I don't want independence from India. I want independence within India. Please create it. Nobody will give it to you. You will have to scratch it. No power has ever given independence to another body without that being national. I dislike all those people जो तोते पालते हैं और बोलते हैं मैं इसकी बड़ी ख्याल करता हूँ. हमें तोतों की तरह नहीं पालता. When we talk of freedom, the concept will be bird. Flying, because even we don't talk of freedom and elephant, because that poor fellow has to still walk on the ground. A bird which can fly, go anywhere, without any entrance. That is the concept of freedom. So why are we trying to keep people in enclosures? Break those enclosures, if you can. If you can't, even Christ said that fight against injustice. If you can't fight, speak against it. If you can't speak, at least think about it. So that's the important. Thucydides was a Roman philosopher in 467 BC. So many years before Christ, means almost 2500 years ago. He said, the nations which differentiate too much between their scholars and generals. Scholars and generals. Are doomed to have their battles being fought by cowards and their strategy being planned by fools. So we have to group them together. Don't put them apart. But do you see it around yourself? Do you see army, even a university for army defense university has been perpetually happening for last 40 years, but we do not see, till the first brick being laid. For police, there is an academy which is going to come up near Shiva, and they already earmarked the land. So, means, there is a dichotomy. I'm trying to point out that there is a dichotomy deliberately keeping army uneducated, policeman, an inspector has to be a graduate. But an officer can be a non-graduate. Why? Are we trying to keep them uneducated? When I was serving in the army, I was a colonel at that time, and I proposed that we should increase the level of intake of the education of the soldiers. So there was one General O'Brien who had lost his leg in war, a very brave man, etc., etc. So he took me aside during the tea break. He said, "Sheonan, if you take educated people, they won't want to die for your nation." So Manager said, "You are in a contradiction in statement and existence." He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Are you educated?" So he said, "Yes." I said, "You brought your war? Right? In war?" I said, "Yes." I said, "That means I should understand that you made a mistake. Otherwise, you're an educated man. You shouldn't be right." Means if an officer is willing to die as an educated man, why not a soldier? So there is a lot to be seen in between and everywhere. There is a deliberate effort. But Nehru said, "I don't need army, my police is good enough to look after my borders." And because of that statement, the responsibility for our border, where it will be, is of NEA. Wo khamba lagega kaam. Us khambe ke upar chuna kaun karega? MHA. Defense only if enemy comes. Why? And now, this present government, they have given the responsibility. I hope I'm not eating into it. Are you all enjoying? Yes. I don't care about this. So, they said that the MHA will look after where it should be. Because, why? Because Patan Nehru said that my police is good enough to look after my borders. Therefore, IDPB, BSF, Assam Rifles, and SSB, all these troops have been created to look after the borders. But still, where it matters, 100% of their army dies there. But army is not responsible for the borders. They are only responsible to push the enemy back when it comes. Army doesn't have the wherewithal and resources to see even 5 kilometers beyond the border. That is the entrance. Intelligence agencies, CIA, NIA and all these people who are part of police. So means, why is it so? Where is something amiss? There is something amiss. Means we are keeping our people uneducated. And I blame my creed in OGs who do not speak even after retirement. And first Chaman said that I did not let anybody know that I was related to Bhagat Singh when I was in the army. It's not because I was scared. There is a reason for that. If I did anything good, I was supposed to do it because I was related to Bhagat Singh. If I do anything bad, what a Manushya, look, belong to such a family, and the other thing. So that's the reason I didn't want to lift this extra burden of carrying Bhagat Singh on my shoulders. So I let him be at his place, and I joined him now after that. I hope you have enjoyed, and I hope I have conveyed what I wanted to. If I have not, but at least you know that there is much more than what these people told you about Bhagat Singh. Much more than that. Going by the English language and what is written here is not the essence of Bhagat Singh. His being, feeling of his personality, feeling of his presence, and feeling as if what he has said means it. Even if 10% of it comes to us, there are so many people who died with him who did not even understand 10% of him. Particularly Sudev and Rajguru did not understand him at all. But still, Rajguru was from a very poor family from Maharashtra, and his mother came, mother and sister, they pawned their house to travel to Lahore to meet him before he died. And when they reached there, they were told that Bhagat Singh's grandmother and grandfather had not been allowed to meet him because they were not considered blood related, and therefore his mother and father also did not meet. So this lady and her daughter, they did not meet Rajguru. That is sacrifice. They came this far to pawn the house that they had. After coming there, when they saw what had happened to others, they joined them rather than meeting their son. In case of Bhagat Singh, at least his father was visiting him very often because he was in law. But they had come for the first time after so many years. So something means which is very touching, which should also be conveyed and remembered so that you understand the magnitude of sacrifice is not only dying, it is much more than that. Thank you very much.